morning, saints of God. Here it is, Tuesday morning, and hope you had a good night's rest. It's Food Bank Tuesday, and we do need some help, but come on out there and help us with Food Bank Tuesday. All the help would be appreciated, and so think about that, and just think, when you come out there helping today, this passage of scripture can apply partly to you and to your life as you're helping serve the King out there. And what a great story we have today. We're in John chapter number 5, one of my most favorite passages in the Word of God. I absolutely love it. John chapter number 5, we'll be looking at verses 1 through 16. I know it sounds like a lot, but I believe it'll go by fairly quick. And it's one of those powerful stories where Jesus has compassion and mercy, and he heals a man who had been on a mat for 38 years. You know, 38 years was the average lifespan of a Jewish man back during the days of Christ's time. And this man would be on the mat a full lifetime, and Jesus would have mercy and compassion and healing. What a great story it is. But it's more than just that story. Once again, we see our Lord Jesus Christ fighting with the forces of evil. And this evil was the evil of legalism. He comes in, and they think that they are self-appointed gods, and they come in thinking that they own the Sabbath. But Jesus is going to teach them differently here. And I just love the way the whole story unfolds and shares with us the great truth about the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. He claims to be equal to God. Now, I'm going to tell you something. That is an amazing thing. And that, and for that reason, is why the Jews would persecute him, and it would be eventually the reason why they would crucify him, is because he said that he was equal with God. So let's look at the story here. You know, Jesus had been ministering in Galilee for some time, which probably could have been several weeks or even a few months, and he traveled from Galilee down to Jerusalem to observe a feast of the Jews. John doesn't tell us which one. He really points out when it's a Passover feast, but the other feast he didn't really give us by name. And so it's a feast time. It's one of those feasts, undoubtedly, of the three feasts that there are, that the Jewish males had to go, if they lived within 20 miles of the temple, there to they had to go in person. And so, you know, earlier, when Jesus went into the temple, we saw this, he claimed ownership of Judaism's most, you know, visible symbol, the temple. His purpose was to restore worship the way it should be. Well, now just think, here he is on his next visit to Jerusalem, and he claimed ownership of Judaism's most treasured institution, and that's the Sabbath. Boy, the Jews by the Sabbath ran everything, and they showed their legalistic powers and abilities to bring the whole nation to a halt. His purpose on this occasion was to administer grace to those who need it. And we see this going on. Look what it says in verse number 1. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there at Jerusalem, there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethsaida, and having five porches. Bethsaida is the house of mercy. And in verse number 3, it says, in these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the waters. When we understand it, John tells us the story in verse number 4, for an angel went down, this is what was believed, some Greek superstition mixed in with some Judaism, for an angel went down to a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. And whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole, whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. Wow, can you imagine that? This man been laying by that pool for 38 years, waiting and needing help to get into that pool so that he could be healed. Now I want to tell you something. There was no healing powers there. This was a complete superstitious thing, and it never happened. But we see something is great going to happen, because in verse number 6, wow, there he is, the King of life. There he is, the man of mercy. There he is, the compassionate Christ. And so as we see him, he says in verse number 6, when Jesus saw him, and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? And you know, it's very interesting how this thing unfolds, how that Jesus asked him, you want to be healed? And look what the man says in verse number 7, the impotent man answered and said, Sir, I have no man. He didn't know who he was talking to. He didn't realize that the King of Glory was standing there in front of him. When the water is troubled, to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another step is down before me. In this race of the invalids, he was always beaten out. He never had the opportunity to be first place. And so he didn't have a man. And he stresses, if you go back and look at the Greek, he's stressing a man to help him. He clearly recognized his helplessness. He saw that he needed help. However, the object of his faith was confused. He hoped for some type of superstitious healing, perhaps because the temple of Herod had failed him. Generally accepted theology, but he needed this healing, and he would not find it. Not even would he not find it, but because of the Jews feeling that anything like this, any infirmity, was God's judgment on sin. And so not only that, he would find no mercy there at the temple or at the house of mercy. So in verse number 8, Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. Wow, that's amazing. And you know, John kind of plays it off. But he says here in verse number 9, And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked on the same day, and that was the Sabbath. Now, undoubtedly, John is teaching us a lesson here. He's wanting us to realize this, that this is the Sabbath day. He's pushing that. He's pushing to show us that Jesus Christ is the Lord of the Sabbath, and as he owns the temple, he owns the Sabbath. And so, in doing this, we miss a great, I think, storyline that's going on behind the scenes here. Now imagine a man being in bed 38 years, unable to walk. Can you imagine the filth and the stench that he was lying in? Can you imagine the hopelessness that he felt throughout his life? And all of a sudden, Jesus comes and Jesus heals him. I imagine this guy is so excited. He's running up and down those colonnades there. He's telling people, I'm healed, I'm healed, I'm healed. He's doing cartwheels. And just think, all those years of that, the muscles dying inside him, causing that atrophy, and then also his hope being withered away, and all those things, and now he is healed. John tells us that it was the Sabbath. Well, John is driving home a point, but I don't want you to miss the blessing that's going on the other side of the page that we can't see. And so I would imagine he skipped, he leaped, he did all kinds of running in circles, and everybody at that pool must have been excited, and what a sight it must have been, except for some Jews. In verse number 10, we see this, The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It is the Sabbath day. It is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. You know, not one of them said, oh, praise God, you're healed. Not one of them rejoiced. Not one of them came to the place where they were happy and excited. But no, in their legalistic fashion, in this way, they began to throw a wet blanket right back on this guy. And what a sad commentary it is. You know, legalism is the establishment of standards carefully selected by the people for the purpose of celebrating human achievement under the guise of pleasing God. These guys had all these rules, they had all these laws, so they could flip their religious lapels and tell people how good they were. And the whole time they were doing it as if they were serving God, when all they were doing was serving themselves. And that's how legalism is, folks. We need to be careful of it. In verse 13, we find out he answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. And the man said, I don't mean to be breaking the law, but let me just tell you something. The guy who is the life giver, the one who is the cure, the one who owns the Sabbath, he didn't go into all those words, but he said, that man there told me to take up my bed. So you better confront with him, because he's the one who said to do that. Then ask they him, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? We are going to cut his head off. We're not excited. We're not happy. We're going to cut his head off. In verse 13, and he that was healed wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. In other words, Jesus hid himself just to see all these things as they worked out. In verse 14, after Jesus findeth him in the temple, he said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. And verse 15, the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Now look at verse number 17. But Jesus answered them and said, Jesus answered them, my Father worketh hitherto, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought more to kill him, because he had not only had broken the Sabbath, but he said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Boy, what a great truth we have here on this occasion, and also on other occasions. He confronted these religious legalists and put them in their spot. This particular healing begs the question, who owns the Sabbath? I'm here to tell you, Jesus Christ owns the Sabbath. The religious authorities claimed ownership of the Sabbath. Jesus responded to those false claims two ways. He said, let me show you, I own the Sabbath. And he said it, how? By working. As my Father's working, I'm working. And then also he said, I own the Sabbath. How? Because I and my Father are equal. Look what he says there in verse 18. Look what it says there. Therefore the Jews sought more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but he said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Folks, I want to tell you something, the greatest news you and I could ever know. God came down to this earth and he communed with men. He died on the cross, they buried him, and he rose again to offer us life by the forgiveness of sins through his work on Calvary. What a great truth we start with this morning. Sorry I went a little long. I wanted to tell you the whole story, but I just appreciate you following along with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for these good folks. Thank you, Father, for them being with us this morning. And Lord, help us to realize that the God we serve is the God of the Sabbath, Lord. He owns the Sabbath. He owns the temple. But Father, he's the compassionate God that has mercy and compassion, Father, on those who are sinners. Thank you, Father, for this man seeing his need and realizing his hopelessness. And Lord, I pray that, Lord, you help each one of us to see our need for the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray that you'd help us to despise legalism, Lord, even when its ugly head shows up in our own lives, Father. Lord, I pray that you'd bless this day. And Lord, help us to serve you in it, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Go serve your king. Bye-bye.